night is absolutely fantastic. All the way from Belfast via Oma, via Enniskill, and via Kirkstown, the one and only Mr. TerryMcHugh!
Is all joining in so far, folks?
Yeah.
Indifferent. Indifferent, I like that. Nice, I don't like asking that question because I'm going to let you into a little secret, and the guys at the back are going to go mental when I tell you this, but when a comedian asks you, are you enjoying your evening so far, truth be known, he's not that bothered. All he cares about is that you enjoy his bit and he go home happy. You know, we're a fickle bunch. And the other reason I don't like asking that is because I don't need to ask it, because I knew before I got here tonight that you were going to enjoy your evening and you would have enjoyed it so far. Because before the gig tonight, my mother rung me, as she always does, and she went, Terry, I believe you've got a gig tonight. And I went, yes. And she says, well, listen, good luck, drive safe, and don't worry, you'll be grand, because I've lit the holy candle. Catholics do, that's what we do, we light holy candles, you see. And that's why I hope if I ever get hit by a bus that there is a Protestant nearby, because he'll be ringing the ambulance while the Fenians are too busy lighting shit. And of course, after the holy candle bit, she lectures me about leaving Belfast and moving to Tyrone and bringing all her grandchildren with me. They're all mine, by the way. And you'd think, I'm living in Tyrone now 8 years. You'd think after 8 years that you'd be used to be being down here. Although, to be honest in saying that, you'd think after 8 years, I'd be used to living down here. Because I don't know if you're aware of this or not. I mean, I take it most of you are from Tyrone, yes? Right. This place is fucking different. It's like, I mean, you just have your own language down here. That's the first thing. I mean, simple questions when asked in Belfast. You know, they mean something entirely different up here. Like for example, Terry, what football team do you support? If that's asked in Belfast, I'll say, well, I support Celtic. And they'll say, very good, or stab you. Depends on where you're at. But down here, that question means something completely different. In fact, you could almost say that it's a whole different ball game. Don't worry, folks, there's fucking worse than that to come. My wife is from Tyrone, and I remember the first time I met my father-in-law. The first thing he said to me was, well, young McHugh, what football team do you support? And I said, Celtic. And he said, no. What football team do you support? And that's when I realised, I went, all right, I'll give it to me now. You're talking about Gaelic football. And then I said a sentence that no Tyrone man had ever heard before. I went, ah, sure, I'm not really interested in Gaelic football. Now, something happened at that point. This look came over his face, and I've never seen a look on a man's face that encapsulated so many different emotions. There was shock, and there was horror, there was quite a lot of confusion, but the main one was disgust. Disgust at the fact that he just realised that his daughter was marrying a homosexual. I genuinely believe I could have walked into that man's kitchen, slapped him on the back and said, well, Mr. Darcy, your daughter is a fine piece of ass, and then stirred my tea with my cock, and he wouldn't have been as upset as he was. There's another question down here. Look, maybe I'm generalising too much. Maybe it's not Tyrone, maybe it's just the wee bit that I live in. But again, in Belfast, if I pull up in my car and say to your man, no, excuse me, sir, I was wondering if you could give me directions, what he will hear me say is, excuse me, sir, I was wondering if you could give me directions. Where I'm living, when you ask that question, what he hears is, hello, I was wondering if I could have a local history lesson. I asked where the nearest garage was. What this guy done was, he didn't give me directions to where the nearest garage is, he gave me directions to where the nearest garage used to be. He told me why it wasn't there anymore, who owned it, and in some weird and wonderful way, he was actually this guy's cousin. You know? And then he proceeded to give me directions, and you know, he was like, right now, what you want to do here now is you want to go straight up this road here now, what'll happen is you come to old Jack's place. Now, old Jack, oh, old Jack, some fella, he's named 4 years, he's old Jack. Oh, he's in the pub every night of the week, 2 pints, stout, 3 cigarettes, up the next morning, half six, milk and them cattle, some fella's old Jack. And you go up the road there, you come to crossroads, now crossroads don't be going right, because if you go right to head for Siskinore, there's no garage in Siskinore, you don't want to go there. He's giving me directions to somewhere I don't want to be. You want to go right
don't go left across the roads. What happens? You come to the bottom of a hill. Now, whatever you do, don't go up that hill. Don't get up that hill. Just veer off a wee bit. What happens? You've gone up past Mervyn's Fields, up there in Mervyn. He's not from around the area in Mervyn. You know, Mervyn moved in here from a parish. A couple of parishes over, he moved in. You know, him and the wife split up, sold up the house, bought him patch land, got some sheep. He's a Protestant! But he's a good Protestant. He goes to all the football around the corner there. You ever seen the football yourself? What football team do you support? Yeah, folks, it's a whole different world. It's a whole different world out here. Strange things happen down here. Like, I picked my daughter up from school, and which is a perfectly normal thing. You know, picked up a daughter, was driving home, as you do, and I was going along one of those country roads. You know the type of roads where, you know, there's only space for one car, and then if you meet someone, you're reversed for 2.5 miles, they find somewhere to pull in. It was one of them. It was like when they were building the country, someone went, what about roads? And someone went, roads, where we're fucking going? You know, and it was there about 20 miles an hour. And like I say, I had the daughter in front seat beside me, came round the corner, that's when it happened. He run out in front of me, nothing I could do, slammed on the brakes, too late, bang. I run over a chicken. I don't know if you've ever hit a chicken at 20 miles an hour, but things pretty much obliterate. They explode. And I'm sitting looking out the front of my car, there's chicken guts and feathers all over it. My 8-year-old daughter sitting beside me. My 8-year-old daughter who is an animal lover. My 8-year-old daughter whose granda keeps chickens, who she's named. I'm going, oh Christ, I've scarred her for life. I need to do something. So the obvious thing to do was put the wipers on and get the guts off the window. That's the first thing you gotta do. So I did. What I didn't realise was that during the explosion, this chicken's neck and head had got caught up in the wipers. My daughter's now watching a dead chicken's head giving it this shit. That's when, oh Christ, I've scarred her for life. This is horrendous. I'm just going to have to turn around, look at her, face this mom up and deal with it as best I can. And I turned around and I looked at my young daughter and what, you know, she was sitting there, God love her, you know, she was in tears. She was in floods of tears because she was wetting herself laughing. She thought this was hilarious. She was laughing at the absurdity of it, just like I wanted to do initially. And I was like, you know, that's when I realised what should have been a horrendous moment became a very touching moment, because that's when I realised that wee Erin was daddy's little girl. She was definitely just like her daddy. And then what happened was what should have been a horrendous moment that became a touching moment became the proudest moment of my life, because my 8-year-old daughter turned to me and she said, verbatim, that means word for word, big man. She went, verbatim, daddy, there's one chicken that didn't get to the other side. Yes, folks, you pay attention here, man. That is skinny with a girl's haircut to a chicken draws their own jokes. Yes. But of course, the question has to be asked, you know, Terry, well, you know, if you knew all this before you came down here, why did you make the move? Why did you move down this way? Like, you know, but my wife's from just outside Oma, and she wanted to move home, and she occasionally let me touch her, so I thought, you know what, I'm going with you. And I know, the skinny-looking freak from Belfast got himself into her own woman. How the fuck did that happen? I'll be honest, I'm not sure. But I must be doing something right, because in 11 days' time, me and her will be celebrating our 10th wedding anniversary. Yes. Yes. You seem a lot happier about that than she is. Oh, 10 years married, you know, and she's a very supportive woman, is my wife, you know, and it's in her nature to be supportive. She's a teacher, you know, she has to be supportive. And I've learned a lot from being married to a teacher because, you know, and I think the main thing that I've learned is, and all the guys, write this down, okay? If you ever find yourself going out with or married to a teacher, and let's just say she goes away for the weekend with her sister, it is not okay to get a substitute in. Because the fuckers cost £90 a day. Oh, God, and you know, the other reason I moved down here was, you know, I got a job, I found a job down here, and it all kind of worked out well, and I'm not really meant to talk about the job, I'm not really meant to talk about it, because I don't do it anymore, and they said if I ever mentioned them on stage that they would sue me, but you know what, I'm worth fuck all. I used to manage a mobile phone shop in Fermanagh. I can't give you the name of the mobile phone shop, as I say. What I can tell you about them is that they keep all of their phones in a big warehouse. I'll let you think about that one for a minute. You know, and there's a couple of reasons I quit that job. One of them was, like I say, the phone shop is in Fermanagh. I get sick of selling smartphones to stupid people. Anyone from Fermanagh in? There is! Ah, you escaped. Well done. But no, and the other reason I quit was that I despise mobile phones. In fairness, I despise all modern technology, and I know that makes me sound old, but I come from a time when if someone handed you a tablet that cost £150, you looked at it and went, by Christ, this is going to be some weekend.
I save most of my hatred for the mobile phone. You know, because nobody talks anymore. No one talks anymore thanks to the mobile phone. I mean, about 90% of the conversations these days finish with the other person going, "Aye, I seen that on Facebook." No, but you see Betsy had her challenge. Ah, I seen that on Facebook. Oh, such and such a split. Oh, I seen that on Facebook. That's what's happened to the world. And it's all down to, as far as I'm concerned, it's the fault of the iPhone and the BlackBerry and the Android smartphone. You know, they're ruining our lives. And let me ask you a quick question. Who in this room has an iPhone, a BlackBerry, or an Android smartphone? 1, 2, 3, give us a shout. That's most of you. Right, let's try something else. Who has a Nokia? Couple of people shouldn't be allowed out on their own. And there was once a time I could have asked that question in a room full of people, and the entire room would have went, "I have a Nokia. In fact, I have a Nokia 3310. I'm going places." Who remembers the Nokia 3310? It's a fucking bad state of affairs, and the biggest cheer of the night is for a mobile phone. This is what I'm getting at. Now, if you don't know what a 3310 was, if you're young, a 3310 was basically a phone that done phone calls, it done text messages, and it done Snake. It's all you need then, it's all you need now. And I have a plan. What we're going to do is just going to do away with the iPhone, the BlackBerry, and the Android smartphone. We're going to do away with all that. We're going to get back to these simple phones, and we'll all start talking again. And here's how we're going to do it. Okay, now I know, Terry, we're here for comedy. It's turned into a mobile phone marketing seminar. But run with me on this one, okay, because you're going to love it. Basically, what we're going to do is get a phone like a 3310, make it the most desirable phone in the country again. Everyone will want to buy it. Here's how we're going to do it, folks. I put on the Nokia. They are releasing a new phone. They're going to call it the Nokia 1690, and they're only going to sell it on the Orange Network. The Nokia 1690 will only have one ringtone. It only needs one. It'll be the sash. It will ring louder when outside a Catholic chapel. Even when you thought you'd a bugger on silent. It'll come with the latest version of red, white and Bluetooth. And it'll have a built-in sat-nav, which is will not offer you an alternative route. And by request off the Orange Order, they want every single text message sent from this phone to finish with the letters LOL. But the thing is, folks, we can't just make it for one side. We're going to make this work. If we're going to save humanity and do away with very, very smartphones, what we have to do is we have to make sure we get both sides of the community. So we're going to release a second phone. It's going to be called the Nokia 1916 Chucky Edition. A phone that won't have a clock or a calendar let you know when someone's ringing or texting, because that phone will tell you now. But even if it had all the bells and whistles, we could still probably put all the bells and whistles on this phone. None of them would work anyway, because it's going to spend all this time trying to convince you that it was never a phone in the first place. And of course, both phones will only come with a very basic 0.3 megapixel camera, because let's be honest, folks, parts of both will always and forever be stuck in the fucking past. Stuck in the past, says the man who hates all technology. But we are stuck in the past, folks. You know, there are still parts in Northern Ireland that are firmly stuck in the past. They're in the dark ages. They're still back there going, "Come down here where it's dark, it's fun," you know. And one of the perfect examples of that is last year. Topical humour, yes. Last year, what happened was there was a guy from Derry, Martin you call him, you might have heard of him. And what he wanted to do was he wanted to shake hands with this wee owl doll. I think she's German, but she lives in London. Okay, and they were going to shake hands, and like anywhere else in the world, that would have been considered a huge event. Let's celebrate this great thing that's happening. Not here. What happened was that the guys that didn't want it to happen, they made their voices heard the most, and they went, "I don't think that man should be shaking hands with that woman." And no one's going, "I don't think that woman should be shaking hands with that man." You know, and maybe there's some of you in here tonight who think that Martin McGuinness should not have shaken the hands of Her Majesty the Queen. Maybe you think that. But the difference in you and me is that you won't stand up in front of a room full of strangers and admit, "I don't think Martin McGuinness should have been shaking hands with Her Majesty the Queen." Think about it. It was Her Majesty's Revenue and Customs that put Glasgow Rangers into liquidation. Martin should have been hugging that woman. I done that joke in Eaton Arts one night. I'm lucky to be here. We undersell Northern Ireland. We're terrible for it. We go on holidays and we're like, "Where are you from?" "Well, I'm from Northern Ireland." "What's that like, shite?" You know, what's Northern Ireland famous for? The big boat that sunk and then there was a wee bit of bother for a while too. It's shite. You know, we need to start celebrating the things that we've done here. Like, for example, right, there's one thing I think should be celebrated by everybody. And this is what it is. It's there's a movie star from Northern Ireland, okay? Now, this movie star was in one of the greatest movies ever, one of the greatest movie franchises ever, right? This movie star was in it. Okay, and we should be proud of this. Now, you're probably sitting there thinking, ah, he's talking about Liam Neeson in Star Wars. Am I my arse? I'm talking about Back to the Future, and I'm talking about the DeLorean. We did that. That was us. That should be celebrated. Right? And if you, I mean, we single-handedly saved that movie, because when they started filming, the idea for the time machine was a fridge. A fridge. Now, I have a couple of problems with that. One being, how the fuck do you get a fridge up to 88 pounds an hour? The other one being, it's a shit idea. Now, the reason they scrapped the fridge was not because someone went, that's balls. The reason they scrapped the fridge was because they were worried that if they used the fridge, thousands of Americans would die suffocating to death in the fridges during botched attempts to go back to November 5th, 1955. Now, I have been in the America, ladies and gentlemen. You know, I have seen Americans, let's be honest, 90% of them wouldn't fucking fit in their fridge. And 70% of them look like they've fucking eaten one. You know, so they went, what are we going to do? And they looked to our shores and they went, look what they're building, that's what we'll use. And because of that, it became one of the most iconic cars in Hollywood history, you know. And if you can show me a man who doesn't dream of one day owning the DeLorean, I'll show you a liar. We all dream of owning the DeLorean. I would long to own one. There's one for sale at the minute in Belfast. £24,500 the dude's looking for it. And I'll be honest with you, if I had the money, I wouldn't be standing here talking to you. I'd be up there buying my DeLorean, and I would get in my DeLorean, and I would drive home to Tyrone. And on the way, I would find a nice, big, straight stretch of road, and I would hammer up and down that road, and I would do it at 88 miles an hour, and I'd do it all day, and I would do it all night, and I would continue to do it until the cops pull me over for speeding. Picture it, you've just been pulled over in a DeLorean for doing 88 miles an hour. Cop comes walking over, excuse me sir, but could you tell me what speed you were doing? To which I get the reply, fuck my speed, could you tell me what year it is? It's 2013 sir, 1.21 gigawatts, she worked, I'll slam close the door and I will speed off back home to Tyrone, because let's be honest, driving a DeLorean into Tyrone is as close as I'm ever going to get to driving one back in time. Listen guys, as a comedian, one of the big pressures on us is that we have to have a big closing joke. We've got to come up with a big joke at the end and you just all go, Christ, that was funny, and you just laugh and you just clap and you just go mental and it's great. Well, I'm too lazy to do that. I haven't been bothered doing that, right? Now we're all going over a time afterwards for a few years, okay? And you can come up and you can chat to you and you can tell me I was good, you can tell me I was shit. You know, tell me whatever you want. But do not ask me, is stand-up comedy the strangest job you've ever done? Because I get asked it a lot, and the answer is, without a shadow of a doubt, no. It is not. The strangest job title I ever had was international, and you know it's going to be good when it's prefixed with international. International Yo-Yo Champion. Yes. Now, what I used to do was I used to try and tell audiences what an international yo-yo champion done for a living, but people weren't kind of getting it, so what I started doing was showing people what an international yo-yo champion does for a living. Would you like to see what an international yo-yo champion does for a living?
Yes!
Thank God you said that right along the proper dick. Right, here we go. This is a yo-yo, okay? Hopefully you can see this up the back. If you can't, that's why these guys got the good seats down in front. Right. It also explains this fucking thing that is annoying the shit out of me. So here we go, this is a yo-yo. What we would do is we would travel the world, we would do yo-yo tricks. This is a very simple one. You throw it down, spin at the bottom, 1, 2, 3, bang, back to your hand. Simple stuff, okay? Don't applaud that. Once you learn that, you teach them another trick. It's called walk the dog. There you go. Right, this trick, like I said, I've done this in 12 different countries. Everywhere we went, this trick, right, was called over the falls. Until we got here, we had to change it to up the shanker. And of course, if you get this one, and since it's Rock the Baby, everyone say, ah, right, good. And it takes the kids these tricks, and they come to competitions, and then what you would do is, if there was a tie-break situation, they had to do this. This is a trick called loop the loop. Whoever on the most of these won the competition. What you do then is you would learn fancier tricks, you know. I think I broke this one. Oh, here we go. You'd learn fancier tricks, you know. Stuff like that. Easy stuff. But you see, the thing was, when I was doing this, I was 15, 16 years of age. And I was learning to play with the yo-yo and I was getting really good at it. And then I realised that being really good at the yo-yo wasn't getting me the ladies. Now, it was the 90s. What I should have done was to slap enough cool water on me to choke a fucking donkey and I'd have been like... But no, what I done was I decided, you know what? They don't like it when I play with one yo-yo. Maybe I'll get the ladies if I learn to play with two. Now, it's been a while since I've done this. So there's no guarantee this is going to come off. Are them legs expensive, by the way? Remember that looked a bit trickle showing? Right. Look, look. There you go. Like I say, I was too lazy to write a big finishing joke. Right? I heard that. So, what I done was I thought, you know what, I'll take the big finish from the yo-yos and I'll stick it in the comedy. That'll work. Because the big finish from the yo-yos was we could just put the yo-yo in our pocket. I can see we're not impressed. But if I told you the way that we do this is that we flick the yo-yo out in front of us, flick it back, it goes between our legs, comes up around here and lands in my pocket, would you be impressed then? Yes, now, here's the rules of this. This is the most dangerous deadly trick you can do with a yo-yo. Basically, if this goes wrong, you'll know. I'll be on the floor clutching my balls, making a sound like a Bee Gee. So I get three chances at it. I get three goes at this trick. If I do it within the three goes, yous go mental and you take the roof off this place. If I don't do it in the three goes, I'm going to look a proper cock. So here we go. Now, if I do this and it's very quiet, I get a bit nervous and it tends not to work and stuff, so what I need you to do for me, because you know in the Olympics and stuff, when guys have three chances to jump over things for reasons best known to themselves, the audience, give it that clap thing. Can you do that? Everybody then, let's go. Keep that going, okay? Here we go. Go number one. I meant to miss it that time and build up loads of tension and stuff. So now I don't know what to do. I thought it's the big finish. Shit! Swing it off my cock! Yeah! I give you my phone number later and you're welcome to see that finish. You're welcome to see it. Right, I'll tell you what I'll do then. I finish it like this. Yo-yo's off. 1, 2, 3, catch. Thank you very much.